Hello and welcome back to ESC 315. This is Lecture 4. Lecture 4 is in two parts. This is Lecture 4A. In Lecture 4A, I'll go over public participation and consultation. And in Lecture 4B, Ayla de Grand Prix will give a guest lecture on Site C. You might recognize her from ESC 314 if you were in that course. She was doing the course at the same time as at the graduate level. And she did a project on Site C, which was very relevant to this course. So in Lecture 4A, I'll go over some practical lessons on public consultation, and that's mainly from the perspective of a technical component lead or somebody on the proponent side who is going to do the consultation. And it's a lot of the more of the how-to rather than the why. The why to public consultation, I believe, is covered very well in ESC 314. Now, a couple of notes. There are some links throughout this presentation. You'll find those links on Canvas, so you don't have to write down the URL. I'll also be posting the slides to Canvas so that you can just click in the slides if you'd like to do it that way as well. With that, I will transition now to the talk, which I actually gave in class last year. I've shortened it a little bit just to make it a little bit more concise. And I'm going to now start with slide 2. Where I begin by sort of going over one of the examples of consultation that I took part in, which I thought was a pretty good example, and that was about 5 years ago. Okay, I hope you enjoy the talk, and I'll see you next week.
This is me doing some consultation. This is what I would describe ideal consultation. This was absolutely perfect. I had a community member, totally interested, just wanted information. Wasn't sure what the heck was going on, wanted to find out, so took the time and we had that consultation. And in this case, it was very unusual because the proponent usually had me speak directly to all the stakeholders, just kind of gave me free rein. Usually, if you're speaking on behalf of another proponent, everybody's got sort of very tight control over what they can and can't say and do. And that applies to the proponent themselves. If you work for a mining company, you've got to really stick to what, you know, stick within your area of expertise, of course, but also stick within sort of your scope of this particular EIA. So public consultation, as Hannah and Noble say, it's an essential if component of EIA, ensures stakeholder confidence in the process and decisions taken if done correctly. And if the public is actually open to it, which isn't always the case. In environmental impact assessment, the consultation is usually documented, I would say it's always documented in a consultation record, and the government will scrutinize that consultation record, I would say as closely, if not more closely, than the EIA themselves. The government really wants to see that you've done a thorough job and consulted with everybody who needs to be consulted with. So all of your stakeholders, and I've got some more slides on that, but I'll just mention for Site C, there is a consultation record in Volume 1, Appendix G, H, and I. So those are three different consultation records. If I remember correctly, there's a First Nations, general public, and government consultation. And so those are really the big three stakeholders. There are other stakeholders like NGOs and other industries and other stakeholders that you probably need to consult with, but those are the big three that will tend to affect whether or not you can get approved. So the these documents are 500 pages. It's not that, you know, it's I'm not showing that just to show how big they are, but to make the point that these are not even, this doesn't even actually record what was said. This just says, on this date, we went here, we talked about these three bullet points of topics. So, I mean, it's massive. They did a massive amount of consultation. In fact, Site C, looking at their consultation record, it looks like, I mean, just as a quick view, I didn't actually take part in much of it until the very end. So I didn't have the history, but it looks like they did a very thorough job to me. They went many times to many different communities, had open houses, had public comment, official and unofficial. It looked very thorough to me. So public consultation has many forms. Some of them are formal, some of them are not, some of them are mandated. And I'll just talk about each one a little bit. So I talked on Tuesday about laws and regulations. So the Environmental Management Act does have a specific regulation. It's called the Public Notification Regulation. And it's very specific about the types of notification, not necessarily consultation, but notifications by any proponent who is planning to do any sort of update to an existing permit, a new environmental assessment certificate. Any of these things will trigger consultation, and it spells out exactly what the consultation needs to look like. Again, it's very prescriptive, and I tend to really like working under those conditions because you can just read it, you do what they say. It's not a lot of chance of having it sent back. Open house meetings in affected communities. So that was the picture I showed earlier. So open houses, I tend to really like because you do get a lot of people coming up to you. They're very informal. Nobody recorded what that guy asked me. Nobody recorded what I told him. He walked away happy at the end. We never heard from him again. Everybody's happy. Those, I think, are by far the most transparent and open and honest, because, I mean, that guy could ask me anything he wanted and I'd give him my best answer. But the drawback is they're not recorded. They don't really count much as far as the government's concerned when they look at a consultation record. All they see is this company went to this community and gave a presentation and talked with people for 2 hours. That's it. And so it's not very good from the documentation side. But I think in terms of giving people the information they need to understand whether or not they are behind your project or not, that is by far my preference. Another one is directed meetings with stakeholders. So in addition to the public meetings, there are stakeholder groups. And so for example, a local watershed restoration group or a local fish and game society, all of these groups like to be consulted, and it is definitely in a proponent's best interest to consult with them, find out what their issues are, find out if they can help them, but better yet, find out if that group can somehow be engaged in the process. So there's a lot of, this is fairly new, but it's a very good thing in this regard, which is called community-based monitoring. And it's been around for a while in different areas. There are a lot of drawbacks to it. The big drawback is if people aren't trained properly, you can get some really weird data that you that then have to deal with. But the huge benefit is you, as a proponent, equip a community with the instruments. You give them enough training that they're comfortable going out and measuring, and then they go out and measure. They can see the data. They don't have to put some trust in a company who's got a serious conflict of interest in terms of their main interest is to develop a project. It's not to understand everything about the environment, but the stakeholders, they're very, very interested in understanding the environment. They don't really care about the project. They just want to know, you know, is chloride going to be too high for us to drink the water if they're doing a discharge? Or there's all sorts of different community-based monitoring, really any type of baseline monitoring that we would do as scientists can be done by the public, although sometimes in a more simple way. And conversely, sometimes in a lot more frequent way, in a lot more basically focused on their on the parts of the environment that they want. So you train them to monitor, you give them the instruments, you help them with a study design, and then they go out and monitor. So that's really, I was going to say it's really effective, but it's kind of too early to tell in my observation. It's been effective at getting people engaged, that's for sure. In the long run, I think it's going to take several years to understand, is this effective in terms of, are we getting better understanding, or are we getting back a lot of data that we then have to go back and say, well, actually, your data is wrong, because that's a huge problem if you have to do that. So it's a bit risky, but potentially highly beneficial. Another one is site visits. These are very effective. All sorts of site visits, usually a baseline site visit where you, as a proponent, take the stakeholders out on the land, explain to them what you plan to do as a developer, what it'll look like over time, what will change, how long it will last, how it will be reclaimed. That's often the biggest question is people accept that there is going to be a development, but they want to know how you're leaving it when you leave. Because when the industry leaves, it's the general public in that area and all the stakeholders who are left with whatever you've done. So they want to have a lot of say in the reclamation, which I obviously support. It's a good thing. So if you're working in industry or consulting, government will do these sometimes. Try and do site visits with stakeholders. It's really worth your while. It's really challenging logistically, but definitely it's good. The other good thing about this, it's similar to the open houses, is that you can get really true two-way communication. You're walking around in a field with somebody, you're conversing, you're not standing up here lecturing like I am right now, which is how a lot of consultation is done. They fly somebody in, they have them give a lecture for 30 minutes, you leave, and the community is going, okay, well, sounds interesting, I don't trust that guy, but sounds interesting. Whereas if you walk around with them for a couple of hours and you kind of actually get to know each other as people, then when you're telling them, you know, this is what the chemistry will look like, this is what we expect the wildlife to happen, or what could happen to the wildlife and how it'll recover or not, at least you've got some personal rapport and you can, you know, build some trust. But like I say, most importantly, you can hear back from them and say, you know, they'll tell you, don't go anywhere near that wetland. I don't care what you do, just don't touch that wetland, go build over there. And sometimes that's an option. So you can get a lot of good feedback by talking to people, which is very different from when you receive written comments. You don't know really who wrote them. You don't know what their background is. You don't know why they're writing them. It could be somebody in Australia who's only heard of the project on the internet, and he writes a letter that says all of these things. You just have no idea with a written comment. But when you're talking to people, you can really understand what are their issues. So another thing that's unique to BC, so there's a public comment period that the proponents have. So there's several times, and it depends on the type of environmental impact assessment, but each type has its own sort of flow chart of when is consultation required. At key milestones, you must consult with this group, this group, and this group. And so, it's very well spelled out. The mandated part is the timelines for the government to actually process it. Because with all of these things, the government's got to look at the consultation record. Have you done a good job? Have you, done enough that we can move you to the next phase? Comparing the technical information to the consultation that's been done. And so this puts them on the hook. But it's actually... is it a law or a regulation? I can't remember. But it's a legally mandated time. They have to get back to the proponent within 30 days. Some things I think are 60 days, but most of them are a 30-day turnaround. The government has to get back to you with an answer. And again, I'll use Alberta as an example. You submit something to the government, they have no driver whatsoever to get back to you on time. So you can submit something to the Alberta government and you won't hear back for months, sometimes years. It's kind of reminds me of this story I read recently about a guy who built a dock. Did anybody read that story? Built a dock in Kelowna, and he had a lot of trouble. I don't know the full story, obviously, I just read the news, but it looks like he tried and tried and tried to get permits. He tried to work with the government, and they kind of stalled. And the problem is for the type of permitting he was doing, I'm pretty sure there's no mandated time, otherwise the government would have had to get back with an answer, yes or no. And you sometimes get these political hot potatoes where the government doesn't want to say yes or no, they want to sort of just kick it down the road and let the next minister deal with it, or whatever the case is. It looks like that's what happened here. So finally the guy just went ahead and built the dock, and I think he got to use it for about 2 years before he had to apply for some other permit. And when both the city and the province update a permit, they'll first check, are you in compliance with everything else? They check that and they go, oh, actually, you're out of compliance on that dock, and we're not going to permit you for that, so now you've got to tear it down. So it turned into a big legal battle. The number $700,000 kind of rings to mind. I don't know if that's what he actually spent, but it's in my mind. Anyway, it can be hugely expensive, hugely inefficient. The mandated times, at least you get a yes or no. If that guy would have just gotten a no, it would have saved everybody a huge headache. And then public hearing. This is an extremely formal process. Usually what happens is you have panels of experts, and sometimes the panels of experts will speak. Rarely they'll speak to other experts. The joint review panels like to avoid experts versus experts as much as possible, because what you get into is really nerds going into the weeds and talking about details that nobody else cares about. It's inevitable. So what normally happens is there will be stakeholder groups, including the government. They each have a lawyer, and the lawyer grills an expert. And there's pros and cons with that. The big con is that lawyers use all sorts of crazy tricks to get you to discredit yourself. That's kind of their first modus operandi. The other drawback is the lawyers have sort of a list of questions they'll ask you, and once they run out of questions, they can't really dig into stuff. And so, I'm not a big fan of that process. That is the typical joint review process. The Site C had a different process that I've never seen, but I actually think it's the best one I've ever seen. In the joint review panel, I'm trying to just remember this. So in the joint review panel for Site C, it was typically, there's a chair, three people, and then expert panels, so two rows of maybe six people per row. So all of the BC Hydro people here, all of their technical experts here, and then general public over here, and podium. And so the way they did it is they would go through the stakeholder groups. So the stakeholder groups could come up, and it could be the lawyer, it could be an expert, it could be general public, whoever it was. But they could make a little speech and then ask a question. What was different here is that the general public would ask a question of the panel. If the panel thought it was a good question, they would then ask the experts. But they served as a filter. So you don't get lawyers playing games. You don't get people going off on crazy rants that you then have to answer. Basically, they served as a filter, because ultimately, regardless of how this is set up, the whole thing is intended for these people to get the information they need to make a decision. A public hearing is actually not intended to inform the public. It's intended for the public to inform the panel to help make them make a decision, and the panel will then turn to the expert and say, have you assessed this? Is this accurate? You know, can you explain what this person's talking about? Is this something that's in your assessment? And if so, give me a reference and we'll have our staff go look it up. But it was really effective. It really, really cut down on sort of useless technical discussions that tend to happen. There are some principles. This is from Noble's textbook. So adapted to context, understanding culture and values. This is obviously extremely difficult, but the more consultation you do, the more you will understand the culture and values. So the first time an industrial proponent wants to come to a community, they're not going to understand that community. They just won't. Every community is a little bit different. But the more they consult with them and the more they do things like site visits and open houses, eventually they will start to understand the culture and values, and they can tailor the EIA as well as their consultation around that. So informative and proactive. Informative is kind of obvious, but proactive here makes a huge difference. If you follow the BC's regulation and you only consult when it says to consult, there's no way you're getting approved. It's just not a chance. You need to go to communities and talk to them beforehand. It's just completely expected these days. There's no tolerance for companies to come in and tell you how it is, and this is our mandated time, and we're here, everyone knows you're there to kind of check a box on a government form. So you need to be proactive and talk to people in advance. Also, if you go to them after, they know that it's a done deal. This company's coming to do what they want to do. They're here saying they want to consult, but even if they listen to us, it's too late to make any changes. there's a saying a friend of mine uses, if you come to consultation with a blueprint, you come way too late. So you want to come before that blueprint is conceived of, ideally, and help the community shape your project. And I have seen that in some cases, it does work. I'll say the Tech Frontier project did what I thought was an incredibly rigorous job of consultation. They consulted far and wide with everybody early and often, and in the end, they got a lot of the stakeholders to sign on to the project. So adaptive and communicative. This says recognize the heterogeneity of stakeholders. So again, it's a little bit like the first one. Not all stakeholders are the same, but that doesn't just refer to their culture. It also, in a big way, it refers to people's knowledge. There are some very knowledgeable stakeholders, and then there are some people who just, you know, they just want to know the basic facts. There are some that will come and ask really technical questions. Educative, kind of obvious. Imputable, don't feel bad if you don't know what that means. I had to look it up. Basically, it means you're going to take their feedback, you're going to adjust your proposal, and you're going to report back. So basically, there's true feedback there. Reporting back is very important. So you want to go to an open house. Next time you go to that open house, it's really great if you can start by saying, you know, we heard you. This is how we've modified the project. If you can do that, you're set up very well. And then cooperative. Again, the more informal it is, the more cooperative it's going to be. The more formal it is, this type of thing, you can't get consensus in this format. All communication is kind of one way. You're not going to get consensus. And that's public hearing. It's kind of too late. If you haven't got consensus by then, you're sort of doing the design and defend. So, consultation. So aside from kind of the best guidance or the best practices I said earlier, this is just some practical guidance. Again, be open and transparent. I would apply that to any scientific endeavor. Be open and transparent. Although openness may be limited by the proponent, if you're a consultant to them, you'll have confidentiality agreements and you have to be careful about that. It's pain in the butt. But the amount of openness varies widely depending on a lot of factors. But it is fair to say that the bigger the proponent, the more tightly controlled. So these huge multinational corporations, they have lots of processes in place that there's absolutely no budging on, really strict security. And that's, of course, because they face protests around the world, they face lawsuits, you know, they're really, really concerned about messaging and everything. So it also depends on the controversy surrounding the project. There are very few projects that would ever go ahead without any controversy whatsoever. But of course, some are more controversial than others. You just have to look at pipelines. Thankfully, I've never worked on a pipeline project, but I do watch them with great interest. And if you look at the controversy surrounding those, it's huge. And I imagine the people who work on those projects don't do a lot of talking in an uncontrolled way. And then the technical complexity of the topics. So in some cases, you will be asked as a scientist to speak in a very technical way or to speak about technical matters in a very layman way. But definitely, if you're going into this as a scientist, the more technical it is, the more you're required. Although maybe people here will end up working as in a consultation group, in which case you don't need to worry about the technical information. Your job is to talk about what the company will commit to, what the company won't do, all of that sort of stuff, and you turn it over to the technical people. And then the sophistication of stakeholders, that generally the more informed they are, the better, but not always. Sometimes they can kind of derail things by bringing up issues that are difficult to answer, even though you know they're not really an issue, but you haven't done the work to support that. So that can be a challenge. And then the stage of EIA. In early EIA, it's probably actually not best to have scientists going off and talking to the public because we care about lots of different stuff that really isn't all that important at a preliminary stage. We like the science and kind of the nerdy aspects of it, but if it's preliminary, we can sort of get ourselves in trouble by talking too much about things we don't really have settled yet. So it's better to have it final as, you know, as a qualified professional to have your final information in front of you. At least then you know this is what we've found. We've done a full rigorous analysis, and I'm happy to speak about it. The biggest thing, I'll just mention a couple of big problems that people can run into. So know your material. People unfortunately tend to be afraid to say, I don't know. For whatever reason, when somebody's asked a question and they don't really know, the natural tendency is to just speculate or to say, I think this, I think that, but that can get you into a lot of trouble. It's way better to say, I don't know, I'll check and I'll get back to you, and then get back to that person as soon as humanly possible. It's way better just to say, I don't know. So that's actually a skill that's difficult to learn. At least, maybe I'm just a know-it-all, I don't know. But never opine, speculate, or entertain hypotheticals. You'll often get a lot of hypothetical questions. There are plausible hypotheticals. So a hypothetical is, what if this happens? What if that happens? And there are some plausible hypotheticals, spills, accidents, and malfunctions. Pretty much every EIA has to have a large volume on spills, accidents, malfunctions. What happens if everything you've assessed goes wrong, or anything that happens on this project goes wrong, and it's not in your assessment? Is there some kind of contingency plan? And that's really what it's all about. You're not actually doing a big assessment of all of these malfunctions. You're basically, it's more up to the proponent to make sure that they have a contingency in place. If a pipeline ruptures, you've got a plan to call the community. You understand approximately how far your contaminants can go. You've got valves every kilometer that'll shut things off. All of these things, you need to be ready to answer those if it's a plausible hypothetical. The implausible hypotheticals are the things that can get people into trouble, because someone will say, what if this happens? What if that happens? And it's really not really a plausible circumstance. And then you say, well, this is what we do, or this is how we'd fix it, or this is how bad it would be. Hypotheticals, you have to be really careful about, is it actually something plausible, or do you say, I don't know, that's too hypothetical.